Welcome back, everyone. And our main item of business this morning is the second in a series of evidence sessions looking at the impact of climate and nature emergencies on our remit. And today we'll be focusing on innovation and new approaches to environmental challenges within the rural economy. Welcome to the first our first panel, and I thank you for your patience. Who will be discussing the terrestrial environment? And with us this morning we have Michael Clark, Scotland Chair of Nature Friendly Farming Networks; David Finlay, owner of the Ethical Dairy; Dee Ward, Chairman of Wildlife Estates Scotland; and replacing Rebecca Audsley, we now have Andrew Bauer, the Head of Food and Food and Footprints. So the session is going to take a slightly different form this morning, so I'd like to invite Michael Clark to make a brief opening statement setting out some of the background about his innovative project, followed by David, Dee, and then Andrew. Thank you. Good morning, Michael.
Good morning, convener. Can I just check you can hear me okay?
Absolutely.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much for the invitation. I'm delighted to be here. Good morning all to the committee. We were born less than 4 years ago, and we are a network, a steadily increasing network, a spider's web, perhaps, of farmers and crofters, the length and breadth of Scotland, big, small, male, female, conventional, organic, covering all sectors of farming. And we know that working with nature works for us in our businesses as food producers, as part of the Scottish food system. And we know that working with nature delivers for biodiversity and for climate change. Our mission, as well as running our businesses on a day-to-day basis, is to try and change the mindset of more Scottish farmers and crofters, to get them to rethink the way they farm, and to give them the confidence, we hope, to come with us on our journey, our transition to a more sustainable future for Scottish farming, a more sustainable way of farming, and a way which delivers for biodiversity and for climate change. We're very grateful for the chance to talk to you this morning, to tell you our story. And can I take this opportunity to invite you individually or as a committee to any of our 275 farm and crofting members across Scotland who would be delighted to show you how it works for them as a business. And that's a number which has doubled since the COVID restrictions began. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you very much. And before we move on to David, I've got to declare an interest of being a neighbour of David, and had the pleasure of farming on very, very similar type ground in Borg. So I've often felt his pain. But David, would you like to make an opening statement?
Good morning, everybody. Right. Well, my background is I'm a fifth generation tenant, cheese-making dairy farmer in southwest Scotland, with 125 dairy cows and all the young stock from that through to finishing or breeding, and 250 breeding ewes. We farm 850 acres of LFA, pretty rough stuff. 500 acres of that will be moderate quality permanent pasture. 150 acres will be rough grazing and grub, and 100 acres of mixed broadleaf trees, most of which we've planted in the last 25 years. I spent 10 years in the forerunner of SRUC, acting as an intermediary between scientists and the farmers for 10 years, and then came home and started intensifying the farm. Got disillusioned with that, and then we started our transition to organic, then ecological, and then regenerative farming, as it's called nowadays. And it's been quite an interesting journey. It's brought us into contact with fellow travellers who are farmers, vets, research people, all sharing our experiences And crossing on the way, crossing many industry red lines and finding that, in fact, many of them were myths. And we've thrown away the old textbook. We're now writing our own textbooks, which instead of spending our time and money on what do now seem to be damaging technologies, fertilizers, pesticides, antibiotics, etc., we're now investing in our soils, our crops, and in our livestock, and in the environment, and in the people who are working here. So we've been trying to follow best practice over the years, and we're now moving, we feel confident, towards a resilient, rewarding, environmentally friendly, net zero. We actually have 25 years of soil carbon data, which shows that we are sequestering more carbon in our soils than we emit from the farm. We're also resource efficient and profitable. The most profitable years in dairy farming were after we'd got 10 years into organics, and it was primarily because we had driven out cost out of the system. And we've now moved into cow with calf, as you probably know, which has been challenging, but we're now in a position, we're in our sixth year, and we can see within 5 years we will be back to the level of profitability we had before. So it is that's pretty well where we are and where we've got to. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. And we now move on to Dee.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. My name's Dee Ward. I'm chairman of Wildlife Estate Scotland. I also own an upland estate in the Angus Glens called Rottle, and that is Wildlife Estates accredited. Wildlife Estates is known as WES for short, just so if I mention that later on, you'll know what I'm talking about. But it's part of a European wide label. Wildlife estates are independently assessed land holdings accredited for wildlife and biodiversity. Scotland has the second highest area of accredited land in Europe after Spain, which currently sits at 1.3 million acres. And we have another 500,000 acres in the pipeline going through the accreditation process. We have a target to reach 2.5 million hectares by the end of 2023. Funded primarily by Scottish Land and Estates, with initial funding, generous funding from Nature Scot and ongoing support from Nature Scot. Most land holdings are commercially motivated, i.e. they need to make a profit, we all do. But they want to improve and they want to maintain habitats. Lots have been doing good work for many, many years, and they see wildlife estates as a way for land managers to confirm by independent assessment that they're doing a good job. There are no incentives currently, bar the bragging rights of saying that you've got a wildlife accredited estate, but there are hopes that we're working on this sort of trusted operator status, which and other benefits like maybe easier access into EECs in the future or other grants. The accreditation process, though, is very onerous. It takes a lot of work, a lot of data required, and often, because there aren't the incentives there, though people want to do it, it goes to the bottom of their pile of stuff to do. I think the wider benefits of WES, as I see it, collecting this data is really important for knowing what we have, for driving management improvements, to make better informed decisions about wildlife and biodiversity, deliver biodiversity net gain, and to deliver sustainable farming. Other commercial drivers for the future or opportunities to mainstream, I think, are things like we're all looking at the carbon markets, peatland restoration, woodland creation, etc., natural capital, baseline and measuring improvements. I know they're talking in England about these baseline net biodiversity gain units, etc. Opportunities with things like flood mitigation and water quality through riparian planting and peatland restoration. And there's obviously the new cap coming down the line, which, you know, with this talk of public money for public good, there's potential to encourage good practice and people aligning themselves with doing the right thing in terms of net biodiversity gain, etc. WES is well positioned to scale dramatically and deliver huge environmental benefits, in my opinion, and also biodiversity net gain, but some sort of tangible benefits or privileges, as mentioned, would really speed up this process substantially. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dee. And I'm going to move on to Andrew. I'm going to introduce you properly. It's Andrew Bower. You're the head of food and footprint at the Scottish Agricultural Colleges Consulting. So with your proper title, Andrew, could you give us your introduction, please?
Thank you very much. It's a bit of a mouthful. Yes, my colleague Rebecca sends her apologies. Something came up at the last minute. So I'll run through Rebecca's opening statement. It's primarily concerned with farming for a better climate, which has been back since it was first established in 2011, probably one of the more high-profile knowledge exchange efforts funded by Scottish Government to engage farmers, you know, well ahead of a lot of other initiatives on the subject of net zero. It's run, you know, in various iterations through to 2018, with a very strong focus on climate change. Subsequently, after 2018, the focus switched more to regenerative agriculture, and I'll come on to that in a minute. It was the idea was to have focus farms, hubs around the country where farmers could come together who had an interest or who simply were, intrigued by what was being discussed there. And they drew these 13 focus farms that were established, drew people from far and wide. They were all over the country, all different types of farms. It wasn't just about discussion, but that was an important part of it. It was also about trials and demonstrations. And in the end, over 5,000 farmers and crofters engaged face-to-face at these events. There was also a suite of resources on a website, social media, and outreach through local and national press. In the years since 2018, the focus has shifted to regenerative agriculture, and that has been very popular. I think it came along just at the right time to complement a lot of the others who've already spoken in their efforts. There's five regenerative agriculture focus farms around the country. They are looking at everything from cover cropping to soil health to adding livestock into arable systems and minimising damage from potatoes, tillage, you know, reduced and minimum tillage. And crop diversification and foliar feeds. So again, you know, a really sort of practical focus there. This was both farming for better climate and subsequently the regenerative agriculture network has really been about practical innovation on farm and exploring the bounds of what's possible in a Scottish context. And again, Rebecca's asked me to extend an invite to the committee if anyone would like to visit any of these regenerative agriculture focus farms, then she's very, very happy to facilitate that.
Thank you very much, and certainly we'll certainly consider the invitations. It'd be nice to get out and about again, and that's certainly something that the committee intends to do. We've now got opportunity for questions up till about 11 o'clock, and I'll kick off, and I'm going to ask a very broad question. But I would like you to consider how you think your projects or schemes are going to contribute to solutions to address the climate emergency, climate and nature emergency that we're facing right now, and how scalable are your projects or initiative, and what would be needed to mainstream your identified solutions, and what barriers stand in the way, and I'm going to ask that firstly to Michael Clark.
Thank you, convener. Well, our network has grown beyond our expectations. I think by working at the mindset and giving farmers to get the confidence to start on this journey, I think several of our speakers have talked about a journey. I know David did, and I think Andrew did. You know, having the confidence to begin today, because inaction is the biggest threat to our not meeting our targets, to not being able to become nature positive and reach carbon net zero. So doing something, making a difference today. And what we can do through the network is, as I said, it's like a spider's web. You know, it's immensely scalable with support. And that would, from you, please, would be in terms of giving us this sort of opportunity and supporting policies from the Scottish Government. that support wildlife-friendly farming, that support climate-friendly farming, you know, that support nature-based solutions as much as technological solutions. We feel, our members feel, that we've pretty much got most of the technological solutions we need, that if we just are helped with things like, you know, establishing the baseline, so carbon audits, I think that's already on the agenda. So you need to know where we are, for starters. Then focusing on soil health, you know, soil tests, that sort of thing. So that tells us the direction to take. And then helping with knowledge transfer. I think Andrew mentioned, didn't he, knowledge exchange. You know, we call it KTIF, don't we, Knowledge Transfer and Innovation Fund these days? You know, a bigger pot for that would be enormously helpful for us, because I think we feel that, you know, a lot of the responsibility has to be on farmers. We think, and crofters, we think our role as farmers and crofters, and I farm, I'm not that far from you, I'm in East Dumfriesshire, but, you know, that we have a responsibility to steward the assets under our management. You know, we need to produce food responsibly and to do it in a sustainable way. So responsibility on farmers, with help from you, please, in the public sector, a collaborative private-public partnership. But we know that there is a wall of money out there in the private sector. There's a tsunami almost of money that wants to come to help us. And if we put our heads together, you know, you as the policy makers and us as the people who can deliver that kind of thing on the ground through the likes of the network, we can encourage and get some of that money to come through.
Thank you. And can I move on to Dee Ward?
Thank you, convener. Can you all hear me? Sorry.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Funnily, I mean, Michael Clark's comments are very, very good, and actually very similar comments. I think from a wildlife estates point of view, one of the challenges we face is, I use a comparison with the IACS form. If you don't get your IACS form filled in time, you don't get your subsidy. Wildlife estates currently, we're relying on people's goodwill. They want to do it, but it often goes to the bottom of the pile. So people don't do the work necessarily, and there's no deadline to do it by. When they do it, they do it, sort of thing. So I think funding is important. I think the private sector funding, opening that up, is important. We talked about this trusted operator status. I think having some benefits to do it, if you're seen as a trusted operator, you know, from a Nature Scot point of view, there's a sort of light touch management. You have your 5 or 10 year management plan of what you're going to do, trees you're going to plant, how you're going to manage your land, etc., and they let you get on with it because you're seen as a trusted operator. I think things like that would be very beneficial, and there are a lot of people keen to do to become wildlife estates accredited, but because of the risk, you know, because there isn't direct incentives, it tends to go to the bottom of the pile. And I think if we could change that, it would go to the top of the pile and a lot more people would come on board.
Thank you. And David, the ethical dairy is often referred to in the Scottish Parliament. It's well quoted in the work that you do. But how scalable is your project? It's good to hear that the business is now profitable and you're looking forward to a positive future. But what is needed to mainstream your type of venture, and what barriers stand in the way of your type of venture coming up quickly and addressing what is an emergency? So we don't have 25 years to transform or become organic. What do we need to make your project a mainstream solution?
I wouldn't expect everybody or anybody particularly to follow exactly what we are doing. But we are in an emergency situation, and you know, we've seen COVID and how we've dealt with that, and we've thrown billions at it. And it's been very damaging to the economy and to the country. We're going to have to face up to the fact that if this is an emergency, we're going to have to invest a lot of money in getting it sorted. And the people who can sort it are the land managers. There's no doubt about it. We can be part of the solution. I'm a bit more hard-nosed. I mean, I agree with Dee and Michael that there has to be government involvement. And I think the government has to take the lead here very much. And I know money is a problem. And I, as I say, I'm pretty hard-nosed. I would say what we need to do is to create an incentive. We need to create a market. The market, the incentive from the market at this point in time is really not there. It's moving far too slowly. I would, if it was up to me, if I was king for a day or whatever, I would be taking gradually transitioning the rural payments budget, maybe supported by some other budget as well, in terms of health and what have you. I would be transitioning at least 50% of that over a 10-year period into supporting public sector procurement. And public sector, we should be feeding our children and our old people and sick people. We should be giving them the best food, and they should be getting food that's been produced ecologically soundly and socially soundly as well. And that would create a market. It would also give a lead to the private sector, as Michael said already. There is a huge amount of money out there in the private sector, but the private sector won't move fast enough until the demand is there from the public. And once the public sector sets the standard that food should be produced to, in terms of environment, in terms of social and welfare conditions, then the private sector will follow suit very quickly, I would say. And for those, I'm hard nosed. If farmers don't want to change, fine. They can fend for themselves, or get out. And they should be incentivised to get out. Bring in new blood. We need new blood in this industry. We've got too much old thinking. So I would put a lot of money into a get out scheme. I know there's one down south started up, and I think we've got to be very careful. We're not just getting the next generation coming along with the same old ideas. We've got to get new blood and new ideas. Okay, does that answer the question?
Thank you, David. That certainly resulted in a flurry of hands being raised for the supplementaries. And I'm going to go to Jim Fairley, followed by Rachel Hamilton. Jim.
Thank you, convener. And gentlemen, I'm loving this conversation already. David, I think you and I should sit down over quite a number of pints and have lots of blethers. The idea that you just spoke about there is one that I took to Ross Finney almost 20 years ago, and it was poo-pooed then, so we'll see where it goes from here. Indeed, I also have a register of interest with yourself, because I actually bought a black-faced tup off your shepherd many years ago as well. So, my questions are, the first thing is, we talk about regenerative farming. But as a new entrant into farming, when I went into it, I wasn't bound by the same constraints of that's how it's been done. So I did things that were what I thought was right. And I always had the environment, because I got involved in farming because I wanted to be out in the countryside and I love nature. So I did things in farming that, you know, I was growing clover 30 years ago, and it's now been talked about as this great new product. It's not. It's been there forever. So how out of touch are the farming industry with nature-friendly farming? And I don't know who's best to answer that. Maybe, Andrew, I'll go to you first on that one. Sorry.
Yes. I think you've definitely hit on something there. There are the people who are already on the journey, and there are those who believe that they don't need to start the journey yet because the language that they hear is insufficiently clear, and sometimes it's insufficiently challenging, or it's too challenging in an unconstructive way. You know, I pick, for example, something like soil carbon. We hear a lot of farmers saying, you know, I'm an upland farmer, or I'm in this particular situation. I know that once you understand the carbon sequestered in my soils, I'm going to be net zero. If they're not actually saying to us, I'm already net zero. We have a farm carbon calculator called AgriCalc that is increasingly looking at soil carbon. I'm not about to say it's the final word on the subject, but we're seeing in a lot of farms that we're looking at that you're looking at around the mid-teens to mid-20s of the percent of the emissions on that farm being offset by what's in the soil. But we need to move the discussion on with a lot of stakeholders and say, you know, you're serving nobody's interest well here by saying we just need to wait until that particular bit of evidence and then everything's going to be fine. But I think we've got to find a language to talk to farmers about that doesn't overwhelm them, because we certainly paralysis, due to conflicting messages is equally a threat to action. But I do believe that we're too busy talking to one another in an echo chamber sometimes, and not actually welcoming in more innovative and challenging viewpoints. We really need that.
And Michael, could you address that same point?
Kind of farm as a boy, and never thought for a minute I'd be able to afford a farm. So ending up here is we're living the dream here. I'm not sure always it's a dream, but it's maybe sometimes a nightmare. So your question was really how out of touch are the industry from nature friendly farming? Well, I think it's this mindset thing that we're trying to address. You know, a lot of the industry, it seems to us, is focused on the top line of their business, the yield. You know, let's see how much we can get out of the resources we've got through using quick fixes like nitrogen in a bag, you know, and see how many cuts of silage, for example, we can get from our fields by putting on more and more inorganic nitrogen, that sort of approach. The message we're trying to get across is have a look at the bottom line, have a look at the profitability, have a look at the maximum sustainable output. You know, by cutting back on your inorganic fertilizers, by putting clover, as you say, in the mix, there's absolutely nothing new that is there. But I think the industry's slightly forgotten it. Not really the industry's fault. We were encouraged by the likes of Aberystwyth and all these places, you know, to put in these high-yielding Italian ryegrass mixes, focusing on the top line. Now, if you put in clover, if you put in chicory, if you put in plantain, you know, as we know, more and more farmers are doing across Scotland. If you try and outwinter your cows for longer, you know, if you try and really cut your inputs, really it's the lowest cost producer that's going to win out here as we go through this period of immense uncertainty and the need to get us focused on nature positive and keeping temperature rise below 1.5, then we think that we know the network's in a very good position to scale this kind of mindset change by demonstrating that it works on our farms and crofts.
Thank you.
Am I keep talking, or you?
If you've got a further supplementary.
Yes, I'm very interested to ask about the private funding coming into farming for carbon sequestration. Really interested to hear how you would see that working, because I know it's one of the things that people are up in arms about is the fact that big companies are coming in, buying up huge swathes of land and then saying my company is now green because I own an estate in Scotland. So where do you see the private money coming in and how do you hold it here?
D Ward?
I think that's a very, very good point. And I think one of the things we want to avoid is that if businesses come in, that they're not only helping us improve what we do and help net biodiversity gain, they're actually, before they do that, are reducing their own carbon footprint rather than just saying just offsetting, which I think is the wrong solution. I think there are huge potential for carbon markets, and what it does is it takes it brings private money in, and it prevents ultimately, if it taken to its ultimate conclusion, would mean you wouldn't require any farm subsidy from the government, and government could spend that money in other places because there's so much private money coming in. But to me, so there's two parts of it. We want to stop and reduce carbon, but the other thing is we want to deliver net biodiversity gain, and I think this is where the whole natural capital comes in, because we need to, if there's a value on natural capital, people aren't, we need to force people by a mechanism, and I don't know what that mechanism is, come in and actually put money into land and farms, into the, not buy land, but to help the operators of that land by putting money into the natural capital and valuing the natural capital. So the money that goes in is delivering a natural capital benefit. And I think valuing anything and valuing natural capital, and unfortunately we haven't valued natural capital forever really, and since the war, people see it as a value and they will respect it and value it more. And I think this is a key driver. How we get there, I don't know, because if you're not careful, the private sector take over and get greedy and jump in. So there needs to be some sort of a mechanism to say, yes, you can do that, but you have to do this at the same time. I'm sorry, that probably wasn't a very good answer, but I'm not sure how to do it. But I do think we need to be wary of it. But there is a potential there if we can get it right.
OK, and Andrew would like to come in this point.
Yeah, I mean, we are involved, I'll declare an interest here. SSE Consulting has a forestry team, and that team is involved in working with land managers to sell the carbon in new planting. Our focus is mainly on integrated planting on farms, crofts in the States, rather than the larger end of the scale, but we are involved in some projects like that. I think it's important to disentangle the headlines from the reality on the ground. Most of the carbon sales that we do are for smaller projects, and I think the companies that we are dealing with, who are, I suppose, a further intermediary in the step, they are aware of the importance of having a range of products. So perhaps, you know, we know that there's products coming onto the market where the farmer retains some of the carbon and they sell some of the carbon later on down the line, so that they have something should government policy or their supply chain make demands on them later on down the line. I think it's always the case where something looks like a gold rush that there are risks involved, but I do think we need to be careful not to, you know, see one or two examples and assume that that represents everything that's going on. There is a diversity of activity, and in some cases it is the carbon sale that is enabling woodland planting to happen. Not so much in the Central Belt where there is a grant uplift, but when you move further north, quite often for us now, it's the carbon that makes it viable.
Thank you. And David Finlay would like to come in at this point, then I'll move to Rachel Hamilton.
Thanks, Finlay. We are sequestering 5 tonnes per hectare per year, and we're emitting 4.5 tonnes per hectare per year, according to AgriCalc. And but if I sell that 5 tonnes of carbon credit, then I'm no longer net zero. And how the industry can sell its carbon credits without becoming carbon positive, I don't understand. And that's the problem. We can't all win from this carbon credit thing, where somebody's going to have to lose. I don't see how you can square that circle. Thank you.
Thanks, David. That was useful. Rachel.
Can I start with Dee, please? Dee, there's two questions I'd like to ask you. Can you tell us a little bit about your integrated land management that you do alongside peatland restoration and moorland management and grouse shooting? And the second point is, you mentioned the AICS scheme. I've spoken to a lot of farmers who've had difficulties accessing the AICS schemes because of the narrow scope of those schemes and also the reduction in the budget from the Scottish Government between 1718 and 2021. Can you talk us through those two points, please?
Yeah, absolutely. Starting with what we do, though I have, just so everyone is aware, we have an 3,000 hectare, 8,000 acre estate, probably 6,500 acres of it is moorland. But on that, we're doing peatland restoration, we sheep farm, we have stalking and grouse shooting, we have hydroelectric. So we're using a lot of the same land for multiple purposes, and also further down. So if you can imagine taking the the estate in three sections. We've got the top, which is the grouse moor. We've got a middle band where we're doing a lot of riparian planting and contour planting of native species, which is to help sort of flood mitigation and also for wildlife and biodiversity. And then at the bottom, we have fields where we can overwinter sheep and so on. And we've sort of remeandered the Rottle Burn, and we work with the fishery board and stuff like that. So there's a lot of overlay of benefits where I think different people, for example, we work with the fishery board, with Angus Council. We've all, you know, Angus Council are talking to us about flood mitigation and improvements to the river further down and so on. So there's a lot of crossover, and I think there's a lot of collaboration that goes on, and I think this is to be encouraged. So that's sort of what we do, and taking up some of the other points that were made, we're very much working on growing all we need on site, so we don't away winter anything. We just grow things like turnips, that we've improved our grassland. Reducing deer numbers has made a massive difference to the amount of grass we have available over the winter. The trees we're planting have a lot of grass underneath them, and actually running the sheep through as they get bigger, they do a good job because they reduce some of the grass. And actually, when the trees get very thick, they're quite good, especially the natural regen, they're quite good at sort of breaking it apart a bit, which is quite good for natural processes. And then we have things like Highland cattle on the low ground that just trample around in the marshy, rushy ground, break that up. And since we've been doing that, we've noticed a huge amount more over winter. Well, waders like snipe, which will overwinter with us. And in the summer, we get a lot of visitors like curlews and lapwing and so on. So it's been really beneficial. It all seems to work together. And I think one of the problems that we've had is since the war, we've been focused on food production, and then things like fertilizers have been invented, and we've forgotten how to farm naturally, which we did 100 years ago, couple hundred years ago. And I think everyone on this call is slowly learning to do that again, and I think that holds the key for us to live sustainably. Moving on to EECs. Yes, EECs, it was disappointing last year. There was a little budget for EECs, but it was very specific. I think this year there has been declared a bigger budget, but the point I'd make on EECs is people, once they're in EECs, they stay in EECs. So if you, it's a five-year term, you tend to renew it and do another 5 years and another 5 years. And actually that money is incredibly valuable to be able to farm in a nature-friendly way. So I think money spent on EECs, I mentioned it in my initial opening for Wildlife Estates members. One thing that would be good if you were, for example, trying to scale wildlife estates is if you could get into EEC schemes a lot easier and there was money available to do these nature benefits or nature-based solutions, I think a lot of people would be, a lot more people would become wildlife estates accredited. And I think EECs is a fantastic scheme, and I just wish it had a lot more money behind it, basically.
Thank you. And can I move to David? And Andrew and Michael might want to come in on this as well. It's really, David, I just want to say my father is an organic dairy farmer, so I've got a register of interest here with a family member. But he complains to me a lot that the price for organic milk is moving very much towards the price for conventional milk. Now, my question really is that if we are to ensure that people, especially in urban areas, have access to high-quality, nutritious food, and farmers are being asked to do more to meet net zero, particularly that will cost money, how can we ensure that the price that we get is relative to the costs associated with meat, the productivity?
Wow. at the end of the day, it's driven by the market and market demand. And I think perhaps, point the finger again at government and say, well, you know, we haven't educated our population to understand the benefits of organic in terms of, not just in terms of the environmental impact and animal welfare impact, but also health, in so far as chemical residues, antibiotics, fertilisers in our food and water supplies. So, you know, the public don't understand that there is a wide benefit, a holistic benefit of from coming from organic farming, or from ecological farming, or from regenerative farming even. And therefore, we are not prepared to pay the extra price. And that then comes back to if good quality, high welfare, environmentally friendly food was being provided to the public through the public sector, which would incentivize the private sector to follow suit, that would create the demand. But it's a demand situation. It also links back to the previous question about connection of agriculture with the environment, how well we understand it. And the problem stems back to, I mean, you know, as a child, I was sent out with a tray of eggs with strychnine in them to lay eggs out on the farm to kill wildlife. And, you know, you got sixpence for it. It was a wee while ago. And that was the mindset. And the mindset hasn't changed greatly since then. And so there is a huge disconnect both at the early stages of learning on the farm, but also through our education system. Our education system does not support environmentally friendly production. So we've got a whole industry which is at odds with these environmental welfare issues I've strayed a little bit from your question, but we have a whole cultural disconnect that requires leadership from government, I would say, because no one else is going to do it off their own bat. To re-educate the...
We've lost David just now, so while we're getting David back, can I move on to Alistair with his questions?
Questions for David, to be honest, so...
Okay,
well... I'll come in if he comes back.
Have we lost everybody? Okay, can we... we'll just suspend this meeting.